making chainmail, one of the most important things to consider is the wire. I use 14-gauge galvanized steel electric fence wire. It is widely available in any local hardware store or online. After 8 years, chainmail made from this is as good as the day it was cut. Turning a quarter mile of wire into a single coil can be very cumbersome, so I have another smaller spool that I use in smaller lengths. Here, I have 2/4-inch steel rods, one to cut the coil into individual rings on, and one to wind the coil upon. The apparatus itself is made from old plumbing pipes. It is used to help wind the wire into a coil around the rod. The spool hangs on top while the wire feeds to the grooves and around the bar to form a long, continuous coil. From there, the coil will be cut into rings, which are used to make the chainmail itself. I start by drawing wire from a larger spool to the smaller. Simply place the rod into a vise or other secure place, slide the smaller spool over the end, fix the end of the wire to it, and turn it by hand. I only use a little for the demonstration purposes, but you can take as much wire as you want. The only difference is a longer coil, and therefore more rings. Precision in winding the spool does not matter, as it will be corrected by the mechanism. When you have as much as you desire, just cut the end. Watch out for any tension that may have built up while winding. I always start winding the coil by hand. Wrap the end of the wire around the shorter end of the bar, here on the left side of the vise. Bring it over to the right side and start wrapping it around the bar in tight circles. I do this until it is about as long as my fist, so the mechanism does not hit the table or vise while winding. Theoretically, you can wind the entire coil by hand, but I find the results are better by using the device. Additionally, it is much faster. Once you have enough wire built up on the rod, slide the mechanism onto the bar. Place the spool onto the top piece, securing it in place with a nut and washer. The wire will feed down through the middle of the pipe, where it will guide to the bar. This mitigates the tendency of the wire to follow the position on the spool. By having a pipe with a close diameter to the outside of the coil, you will be able to turn the device faster and it will yield much cleaner results. Once everything is in place, turn the mechanism around the bar and it will wind the coil. Here is a cleaner view of the device in operation. The coil can be wound as fast or slow as you like, as long as you keep a little pressure towards the fixed end of the bar. This will help keep the rings close together and make the rings as close to the same size as possible once cut. The free end of the bar can begin to sag the further out you go. Also, a heavier spool, one with more wire on it, will increase this dramatically. To support the bar, I took a small length of coil and tied it to a cord affixed to the ceiling. This keeps the weight in the bar from bending it. There is a significant difference in the quality of coil when it transitions from hand-wound to that of the mechanism. By hand, there are holes and gaps where the wire was not kept tight or where the spool was moved from one hand to the other. For the mechanism, there are no flaws, leaving a continuous, perfect coil. The length of the bar does not limit the length of the coil. Once you reach the end, remove it from the vise and slide the bar farther towards the working end. Then, place the coil with the end of the bar inside it, back in the vise, and tighten it down firmly. From there, you can continue working at the same pace without having to break the coil. Make sure that you leave enough space between the working end of the table and the mechanism so it does not hit either it or the vise. When the spool is nearly empty, remove the free end of the wire from where it was kept in the side of the spool. Then, continue working until the end of the wire passes through the pipe around the coil. You may feel the tension releasing, but it will not noticeably affect the size of the coil. When all of the wire is used, remove the mechanism from the bar and the bar from the vise, and the coil from the bar. Next, slide the other quarter-inch bar into the coil. This one will be damaged while cutting, although you can use the same one as for winding if you so desire. Be aware that in time it will no longer yield the same size ring as a new bar would. Having the bar inside the coil while it is cut prevents the inside of the rings from heavily oxidizing and disfiguring from the heat. Place the end of the coil such that it is entirely within the jaws of the vise. Keeping it there will hold the rings once they are separated and stop them from spinning and becoming damaged. This way, you can only cut as many rings as can fit in the jaws of the vise at one time, but in my experience it helps with cleaner cuts. To cut the rings, I use an angle grinder with a 1/16 inch thick cutting disc. The thickness of the disc may be critical to the success of your rings. Too large a cut and they will not close entirely, as I have learned the hard way. For a standard pattern, each ring will have four others inside it. If the ring is too small, it may not move fluidly, sit straight, or even close fully. While cutting, be sure to wear proper safety equipment. Eye protection is a must, no matter where you cut them. Since the wire I use is galvanized, is it extremely dangerous to cut in an enclosed space with poor ventilation. For that reason, I always cut rings outside. Also, I wear a dust mask, as cutting creates a gratuitous amount of iron filings. Cut in a straight line across the coil down the length of the vise. It may be difficult to tell at first if you've gone deep enough, but with practice you can feel when the disc bites into the rod beneath. Once you cut the length of the coil, remove the rings and reposition it in the vise. Repeat this process until the coil is gone. Congratulations! Now you can move on to the actual creation of the chainmail.